Our next speaker is Saina Erheim. She's an award-winning journalist from Serbia. She's a senior media specialist for the Institute of War and Peace Research. Saina, welcome.
Well, it's not easy to start after you. Thanks for that. Well, I'll try that my story will cheer you a bit, although it's not really cheerful. What I'm going to be speaking today is about a story of me turning, or maybe just developing my journalism with activism. And I will start from childhood as well. So my name is Zena, and Zena in Arabic means pretty. And being pretty is really what most of the families in our society would wish for their daughter to be. Nothing else. It's a great investment. If your daughter is pretty, she has much more chances to be able to get better proposal. So married to a rich man, be a good housewife where everything comes to her. Sadly, or maybe luckily, my family didn't have that. I was raised in a very conservative town. I think many of you who follow Syrian news know it. It's named Idlib. The public spaces in my town were very much limited. The only two activities that I could do in my youth were karate and volunteering in the Red Crescent, because my brother was in those two. And I think this picture really represents my childhood and my youth. Like, it was a very much masculine spaces. Everything is so masculine. And that woman on the right, she wasn't from my hometown. She was visiting. What does that mean? Well, for me, my early battles started as a girl and then as a teenager in a patriotic, in many cases, misogynist community and society. For maybe not for not wearing a headscarf. I had the first actual battle when I was 15, and I was told by some of my family members that I must wear the headscarf as all the women and the girls in my hometown. For some reason that really now I cannot tell why, I didn't, and I resisted. And I paid the price for that. And until very recently, I thought that I got all this harassment, which is not just sexual, they were actually touching my body in the street, because I'm not wearing a veil, and I'm paying the price for that. Not all of it was really bad. Some woman would just reach me in the street and saying, you have a very beautiful hair. Why would you want it to be burning in hell? Just cover your head. So that was my my first battle. I even remember the first hug I've ever had. It was, I think, 2 p.m., and I was going to my Arabic class when a boy from the neighborhood just ran toward me and hugged me in front of my classmates. And my teacher was standing on that corner waiting for us to come. I felt really ashamed. I felt like I did something wrong, and they all witnessed my shame at that moment. The last thing I did was deciding to study journalism, and I mean I did to my society and community and even family. I was the first woman in my province to decide to study journalism. Journalism is for men, and it really corrupts the honor of the girls. I do remember two of my aunts were actually sitting next to me saying, like, you know, if you decide to go to Damascus, which is far from here, and study journalism, no man from our province would agree to marry you. You're going to be spinster. Well, I disappointed them a bit. I got married twice until now. I will be moving forward to the uprising, 2011. Well, that's not in my hometown. This picture is in Aleppo. It's after the massacre, the chemical massacre that happened in Damascus suburb, where almost more than 1,000 people were killed by the Assad regime. However, the uprising for me was the time where I actually gained my space in the streets back. In my hometown, in the same hometown where I got the first hug, where I got robbed and I needed a boy to walk around with me, although he is like 10 years younger, just to have a male on my side. I was walking in the streets with more than 3,000 men on my own, chanting. None of them even dare to speak with me. Well, those who are overprotective came and say, like, dear sister, just go to the street side. We don't want you to get arrested or harassed or whatever. And then I was shouting, like, this is my right. I am here as you are. I have the same bravery that you have, so let me alone. And then after, like, more than 10 discussions and debates, one of them really stopped in front of me, and he said, she is my sister. Leave her alone. No one is going to be speaking with her. At that moment, we were passing by my high school, and I was, like, wondering how many of those men actually touched me before. From how many of them I actually got scared and ran the whole way back home. It was a very, like, contradicting moment in my life. I owned the space, and I felt I do belong. In that period of time, I met this incredible woman whose name is Razan Zaitouneh. She is a human rights defender and lawyer. She created the first revolutionary entity, which was called Local Coordination Communities, and I helped her to establish the media office of it. Razan went against all odds. She resisted the regime when we didn't even dare to really say what we're controlled by. We were chanting for it in, like, the forcibly demonstrations, pro-regime demonstrations. We were grabbed out of schools to the streets to do so. She was then defending those human rights advocates or those who dared to be in opposition at that time. When the uprising started, she took a leading role. And funny enough, at that time, the main two bodies of the revolution were led by two women. After being harassed, and then her husband was arrested. I actually do remember that moment. We were working on Skype, like, for 16 hours a day, really. I lost plenty of weight because I forgot to eat at that time. And for sure, all for free. We were all volunteers. And we had this virtual room for news, and then virtual room for translation, and then we would send all the information to the TV channels and advocates and even to the embassies at that time. And, like, suddenly Razan wrote the arrest of Wael Hammadi from this part of the town, and they took that and that. I was like, I couldn't believe what I'm reading, and then I double-checked with a colleague, isn't Wael Razan's husband? And they said, yes. She didn't give him one more minute than any other detainee. She treated him as every detainee that she is documenting and she is writing about. For being that, and for documenting all violations from all parts, she later has been kidnapped by what is called Jaish al-Islam, or the Islam Army, which is supposedly an opposition group. She stood again in front of their violations. She dared them. They threatened her. She didn't respond. She even refused to wear the headscarf in their areas. And she told them, as long as you're committing violation, expect me to report it. Until now, we don't know whether Razan is alive, most probably not. But I can't really do any public speaking without speaking about her. I'm going to go to Raqqa now. Raqqa, which is only known for being the capital of the caliphate. For me, Raqqa was the capital of freedom and revolution. Well, yeah, that blondie little hair, it was me at that time. And what I want to say about Raqqa is that was the first visit ever for me to Raqqa in 2013. When she was captured by the opposition. I was amazed by the amount of women who were active in that town. Every CSO, every NGO that was working there had at least half of their staff or activists of women. They even established a feminist group who were active in that period of time. More than 30 publications were being distributed in it. And this is, like, within 2 months of being captured by the opposition. The last visit I did to Raqqa, it was December 2013, before it completely fell into ISIS. But ISIS were there in December 2013. And it also amazed me again, mainly the women. I do remember I was in a car passing by the main headquarters of ISIS then. So ISIS was there, but there were also other battalions, which are mainly local Syrians. And the women in the streets, they were walking without a headscarf, some of them even wearing like short skirts. And even those with headscarf, they were putting a very bright lipstick, like orange lipstick. Passing by those jihadis in the streets who are completely wearing black, this long Afghanis, looking them into the eyes where the jihadis are just looking down and walking like very fast, passing them by. For me, like I've never imagined that someone would really resist such a criminal entity with a lipstick or with walking in the street. One of them really had hair done very beautifully. I couldn't resist. I like took off myself out of the car and said, "You look very beautiful." And my friend was like, "Dana, you're harassing girls in the streets. Come back. We're going to put us in trouble." This is also in Raqqa, and that was the first ever mixed gender training that I did in rebel-controlled areas. More than half of the girls who attended the training were women. And here I will be remembering Dr. Ismail Hamed. His girl was attending the training, and we had one of the jihadis knocking on our door and saying, like, what you're doing and why you're mixed gender and you have men and women, what you're planning for. And he is the one who stood in front of him, and he said, "That's my daughter who is inside. I trust her. Those are her friends. If you don't believe in that, it is your problem." And he really pushed him out. A year later, Dr. Ismail has been kidnapped, most probably by ISIS, and most probably he has been executed as well. This is also on the Raqqa, and at that time, ISIS has started arresting some journalists and activists. So me and two friends decided to hold these panels to really challenge them. Osama, who is on the right, Osama Hassan himself, was kidnapped later with his brother. And as most of those Syrians who are kidnapped by ISIS are mostly dead. And the sad thing for me is that we always speak about those Westerns who are being kidnapped or killed by ISIS, but no one knows any Syrian or even Iraqi who has been arrested or kidnapped or killed, although they are really the majority of them. Here is another amazing, resilient woman. Her name is Suad Nofel. Even before the international coalition heard about ISIS and decided that this is the ultimate threat for the world, we were actually resisting and fighting ISIS ideologically on the ground. For more than 3 months, Suad was holding a panel and protesting in front of ISIS headquarters in Raqqa on her own. She was holding a panel every single day and stand in front of their headquarters until one of them would come, kick her out, beat her, whatever. She is a teacher. She survived eventually. After plenty of threats, she left. The sad thing that after leaving, like, a woman who has such a courage, after leaving, she lost it all. And she really disappeared. She's in Europe, she's fine. But I mean, as an activist, as a person with such a power, she was defeated when she got out, not when she was facing this criminal group. And in the panel, she says, the prisons of the Iraq, and they're called then Iraq and Sham group, equals the prisons of regime. I did the same too, but not as courageous as hers. I hold this panel in Idlib, not in Raqqa. In this panel, which is dated 10th of July 2013, so also before the world has heard about ISIS, which then eventually accused all Syrians of being pro-ISIS, well, that's a little proof that we really defeated, or at least tried to fight them before that. In this panel, I say freedom for my friend Aksam from the prisons of Assad and Muhammad Noor from the prisons of ISIS. Aksam got out, however, Muhammad is also most probably executed by ISIS. And I put this picture, not to show off how courage I am, but more to tell you about who was the cameraman of it. The one who took that picture for me is Raed Al-Faris. He was a well-known media citizen activist or media activist, and he posted it on their page. So he even took that into their own page, which was very known, and he was known. After the uprising and those lovely images and stories, those traditions, the patriotic society, those extremists really became the upper hand of our society. And then I think everything started to get to the worst case. By the way, all these pictures I took with my mobile phone, most of them I took them like stealing because I didn't have like the enough ability to take them with a proper camera. Then I started becoming suddenly dependent. Well, there is no common between me and the sheep, but we just, both of us needed someone to lead us to wherever we're moving. I've always been an independent and very powerful one, and suddenly, yet again, I needed a man to walk me around, to speak on my behalf on the checkpoints, and in some cases, even to take my camera and film for me. I also lost the battle for not wearing a headscarf, and after more than 15 years, I was forced to put it on again, but only inside Syria. However, like, I am there, I am ready to die for these people and this cause, which is enforcing me to do things that I've never wanted to do. And this is one of the people who were my fixers at that time, and I needed them, and I was really following whatever they're telling me, which is so not me, but I was forced to. And this is how I ended up being, not only with a proper headscarf, but with a long coat as well. And this is the last winter I spent in Aleppo. The main challenges, which I think my main trauma is not really about being barrel bombed, is not knowing the differences between the Sikhoi and M16, all these kind of different machine guns. My main trauma as a journalist is for suppressing myself and applying this different layers of censorship on everything that I do or post. At some point, I stopped writing anything, even my Facebook posts. I start asking some friends to review them before posting them, because every single word that I say has a consequences, and this consequences is not only on me. If I don't wear a headscarf, my garden is going to be punished, not me. So it was like a huge amount of pressure. If I wrote something against one group, as simple as it is, someone might get bothered and shoot me in the street. No one would even question them. It is complete chaotic, and there is no any kind of justice. So for me, from turning in from a journalist who is fighting for freedom of expression, defending that, into someone who suppressed herself was one of the main traumas that I had, and I'm still overcoming until now. The second thing as a woman is being turned into this very weak and powerless, dependent person, not to be able to buy my own grocery on my own, not to be able to stay home on my own, nothing. I always needed someone on my mind, and that someone needs to be man. On all the checkpoints that I passed, I don't have that much families left inside Syria, so I had really to create ones. So I created two uncles, three husbands, and two brothers. And in the Raqqa trip that I told you about, the last one I had, I actually took the ID of the sister of my friend, who was my male guardian then, and I had to memorize all the family members of his, because on the checkpoints, they might separate us, and they did once, and asked me, what's the name of your aunt? To just compare the answers with him to make sure that we relate. So on the regime's checkpoints, I was scared that I might be caught as a journalist or with the recorder or the camera. On the jihadist checkpoint, I was just trying to prove that I am with a man who I am allowed to be with. For some reason, all the IDs for the different girls that I used on checkpoints were for tall girls with brown eyes, and I've never been caught. This picture is took in Latakia Mountains. I was then with a little guy, whose name was Hamoudi. He was 23 years old, studying architect. And he was very much conservative. And he agreed to go with me on this trip because a friend forced him to. We went, and we had so many troubles on the checkpoints. And I was really so upset because, like, at some point, like, this is my country, this is what I aimed for, this is why I demonstrated for, and then you see people who don't know whatever, standing on the checkpoint and asking you this stupid question, trying to prove that you're just with the right person. Anyway, I got really upset. And then he pulled the cart over on this mountain and he said, get off, Zena. And I thought he's going to push me over that because I was giving him a very difficult time. Instead, he told me, take your headscarf off. And I was like, are you sure, Hamoudi? He said, yes, breathe. Take it off and breathe. And he took that picture from me. He is very conservative. He wouldn't marry a woman who is not wearing a headscarf. But he said, keep it off, and the checkpoints need to deal with me, and I will take that. I love headscarf. I think I will marry a girl with a headscarf, but I will also defend you not wearing a headscarf with my life. He lost his life, but not for my headscarf. He lost it for a missile later. But the virtual and real attacks that I want to speak about is more related to us. I think we had that in common. All of us, we are under virtual and real attacks all the time, not only for being women, but for being outspoken, for being in public spaces, for defending human rights. All these simple little things that you do to let go, to enjoy yourself, is something that we need to have strategic plans for. To get drunk, to dance in the streets, to wear what you like without worrying about someone taking pictures for you. A scandal could be you being seen on the beach with a bathing suit, and it happened for one of our female politicians. Having this pressure of what you're doing and not being able to let go is one of the main difficulties, not to mention all this bullying about whatever you do, and this huge projector of spotlight on every single mistake that you might be doing. This is really hard. This is Aleppo. This picture is the reason why I was kicked out eventually from the rebel-held Syria. At that time, when the Charlie Hebdo incident happened, and I decided to take a stand with the journalists who have been killed, doesn't mean I agree or disagree with them, it doesn't matter. What I'm sure of is that no one is supposed to be killed for whatever they do. And sadly, it wasn't only me who paid that price for this picture. It was like my entire family. Even my mom, who was living in Turkey, she was very much scared whoever is knocking on the door. She was checking from the balcony before opening that door. And for some reason, the previous French president decided to say my full name in his speech about the Just We Charlie incident without even checking with me. And my ex-partner was taken into Sharia court with the Hollande speech and with this picture, and he was the one who has been put on the Sharia trial because his wife has decided to commit a blasphemy and support those who are drawing those things about the Prophet Muhammad. So deciding to stand up in these circumstances and then feeling that the world is falling apart and even those who are living very far away causing even much more trouble. What I had in like return from that, like, nothing. Whenever I apply for visa, I still get... the first visa I got to Oslo, to Norway, it was for 5 days. 5 days visa to Oslo. So how the West really respect those who are trying to defend the freedom of expression with their lives, that would give you an example. Eventually, that led me to leave the rebel-held Syria, and I have never went back afterwards. This picture... this is a woman on a motorbike, and she is the first woman ever I've seen driving a motorbike in Idlib province. And it was war. She was completely covered, but for me, that was like an amazing thing to see. And I put her picture to tell you about the extra struggle, the outside struggles. So after doing this Charlie stand, I thought that at least I have a proof now that I am not terrorist. You can really deal with me as not pro-ISIS or potential terrorist. However, at that year, I was traveling to receive Index on Censorship Award in Britain when the Home Office decided to confiscate my passport because Assad regime reported it stolen. Well, they have my like stamp, they have my face, they have my name, date of birth, and I actually studied my master's degree on the taxpayers' money because I got a scholarship. that's all was not enough, because Assad says, I am a stolen, I am a theft, I stole my own passport. That incident led for me to eventually become a refugee in the UK. So at some point, you have a proof that all the world is really against you because you are taking that position to stand against all odds. Surely I can't travel to the US because there is a ban against me because I was born in Syria as well. So what keeps me out? What keeps me going? One of the main things is the support. This picture is in Idlib province, and that's Raed, who I told you about, who took the picture of me with a poster. My friend then forced me to wear the headscarf in Idlib town, and when Raed saw me, he says, why you're putting it on? I know you don't put headscarf. And I said, well, he forced me to because he is going to be dealing with the consequences. And then Raed said, as long as I am here, you be as you are, and no one is going to be enforcing anything on you. And this is like the main square of that town. So I took it off, and we took that picture. Raed was assassinated. Come on, I'm not crying. 2 months ago, in the same town, actually very close to that point. Those people who stand with us, those people who are feminist by action, not by saying, are the ones who are targeted by all parts. Raed established a local radio called the Fresh Radio, and he hired more than 50 local women to work in that radio. He asked me to train them. And then the Al-Qaeda-affiliated group in Nusra decided that women's voices are haram and they shouldn't be on the radio. He kept the women, and he really manipulated their voices and made them masculine with the editing auditions. And they kept working for that radio. And they kept making living out of working in journalism. After his death, you can imagine what happened to those women. This is another picture from my ex-partner. After the Charlie incident, well, poor him. He had to be a free of charge, full-time fixer, driver, campaigner. You can imagine all that. After Charlie incident, I was so frustrated because many of those who were supposedly on my side, who are opposing the regime, started opposing me because I don't agree with their ideas. And by opposing, I don't mean like just disagreeing. Opposing mean don't mind me being killed or report me to be killed. At that point, I was so angry, frustrated, and only two or three people in Aleppo really took my side and stood with me. So he decided to bring all these balloons, and he wrote on them all of those groups who were threatening me, attacking me, and on one of them says Hababin, which are the good people who are standing by me. And I just kicked the hell out of those balloons and then just explode them. So that very simple gesture would tell you how frustrated I am and how essential this little support that we can get at those times can make a difference. Where to go on? That's my little Zara. She's 3 years old, and she was participating in an official event with me in this picture. So one of the reasons that I am going on is that I want her, when she's going to be watching this video at some point, to be very much shocked and thinks that I'm really just entertaining you by telling you those stories, because she wouldn't really understand why I was being harassed in the streets. Why did I have to be threatened or killed for saying what I want to say? And as a person who got through all that and survived in some way, I know how it is for those little girls who are still inside and for their mothers and all of those women who are still trying or still going through all this stuff while we're speaking now. What you can do. This picture is taken in Deir Zor, in my last visit there. Those are girls going to school. And really, at that moment in Deir Zor, there was a mortar and a missile filling every 5 minutes. In half an hour before I get out of bed, I counted 26 ones. And those girls were on their way going to schools. What you can do? I think taking their back whenever someone is trying to attack or stab them in the back, take their sides. This event is named Women Voices Changing the Middle East. Give them speakers, keep the speakers on, shout loud. Whenever you're seeing someone publishing a scandalous picture of a feminist, report him, call the YouTube, call whatever, try to stand with those women. Whenever you're seeing a woman in a very bad situation being bullied and attacked, respond on her behalf. Those small gestures would make them feel supported. They would feel that their struggle worth and they're not on their own. And eventually, when you're very tired and desperate, you can find a kicking ass feminist that you can dance it all off with. Thank you.
Thank you.